Hello everyone and welcome back. I'm the chair for this session. It's my pleasure to introduce Nicola von Tadden. Nico is leading the network engineering team at Qualcomm Regional ISP in Germany. And 2 years ago, he gave a talk about packet transport using VXLAN. Today, he takes us on a journey on how he implemented BGP EVPN as a control plane. So this is like his real life story here. And Nico, off to you, stage is yours.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Florian, for the introduction. I'm Nico. I'm working at Qualcomm. We are a regional network provider in Rhineland-Palatinate. We operate multiple data centers and we have a fiber network throughout the region. We are present in Frankfurt and we were formerly known as Qualcomm Marnet. You may have heard this name 2 years ago when I presented my VXLAN talk together with Florian. We have now since changed the name because we bought Marnet 10 years ago and it was time to do another change. What hasn't changed that much until now was our old network. On the left, you see the AS15945, which is the, I would say, old Qualcomm AS. And on the right, you see the AS21473, which is the former Marnet AS. These ASs have been running separately but interconnected for the last years. Each AS consists of three routers and was present in one POP in Frankfurt. All the routers were connected with each other and were providing a full transit to the other AS. AS Marnet on the right was present at DKIX, whereas AS Qualcomm on the left had a better connectivity to Deutsche Telekom. This had many issues. You see the small names, it says 7604 or 7606, and these are Cisco 7600 devices. Yes, you may think already these are aged. They were good back in the time when they were new, but they aren't so good today. So we had problems. These devices only had 10 gig. They had an aged CPU, and whenever more than one session at DKIX flapped, the whole system crashed and didn't recover manually. So sorry for everyone who was on call last year when our router crashed and their session went down. We fixed that now. We also had a limited routing table, and by design, you only could run one AS per router, including VRFs. We wanted to change that. We wanted to have a new routing setup, which should be at least 100 gig based. It should not have any end of support before 2029, just to have a bit more time and not to replace the hardware again in 5 years. We wanted to have at least 2 million IPv4 routes in FIP. More is better. You never know what happens in the next years. We wanted to have at least the option to do some kind of DDoS mitigation. We haven't implemented it at the moment, but we wanted to just have the option to do it in the later years because the last years had some big changes to networks all over the globe. And this might come in handy in a couple of years or month from now, you never know. And we wanted to have EVPN support. As you might have seen my talk 2 years ago, we already have VXLAN in our data center, currently not with EVPN, but as these systems might integrate into each other or have better handover paths than VLAN, we wanted to have a bit more flexibility in our backbone here. But we also took into consideration when looking for new hardware and new vendor, the number of CVEs this platform had over the last years, and also the location of the production facility of the vendor and also of the headquarter of the vendor. You never know what politics do on a global scale, and we didn't want to be too dependent on one specific country. And we also redesigned our whole network. We went to the drawing board and put together some ideas. Operating two ASs for similar services doesn't make so much sense. So we decided to migrate most of the customer lines into one AIS. We have some customers which have BGP dual homing from us, which are connected to both AIS ends. And therefore, the second AIS is still alive, but running on completely different hardware on a different building with other upstreams. And we do not have a full transit session between the two AISs to not knock one out when a DDoS comes in over the others. It will be just appearing. And we wanted to virtualize our whole BGP routing setup in one layer 3 VPN or VPRN on Nokia. And therefore, we also wanted to have the option to provide a kind of BGP as a service, as running multiple different ASN on the same box to provide different services for different customers. The hardware setup is looking like this now. We decided to go with Nokia hardware, partly because we already had a big Nokia VPLS backbone and the systems integrate in the management and the automation we already have, but also because their headquarter is in Europe and their production is mainly in Mexico, which might come in handy. You never know. It might not. I don't know. We shrunk to 4 routers, 2 in Frankfurt and 2 here in the region, one in near Ludwigshafen in Mutterstadt in our data center and one in Mannheim in another POP from us. The second AIS is running on a Juniper hardware. So we have completely separation between the two ASN and therefore can provide even better service for our customers. Now, what is EVPN? EVPN stands for Ethernet VPN and is an extension for the BGP protocol. It can distribute layer 2 or layer 3 reachability information between routers or switches, because most of the switches nowadays are routers anyway. And the main difference is their FIP size, but the utilities you use are the same. It works with VXLAN or MPLS for packet transport. This is not covered today here because I already had a talk about VXLAN 2 years ago. But in this case, we are using MPLS because it's a provider backbone and we are already using MPLS. But it doesn't make a big difference from an EVPN perspective in production. The good thing with EVPN is you have one BGP session between your routers and it can carry information for multiple virtual routers. You don't have to set up peering for each new service you're using on your overlay. The network topology simplified is this here. On the left, you have your upstream provider, for example, in Frankfurt. You have a virtual router running on router 1, which is connected over EVPN to router 2, which has another virtual router and a customer connection. A route exchange between the customer and virtual router and between the upstream and the virtual router is happening via BGP as always. So it doesn't change anything for our customers. There's no change for our upstream providers. The protocols used there are the same. We still have normal filter lists, max prefix, as you would expect. But in our backbone, we now have a BGP EVPN session between our 4 boxes, which can not only carry this BGP AS, but also information for other networks. It can also carry layer 2 information when we want to provide a transparent layer 2 circuit over these boxes. Some things have changed. You have to activate it. On Nokia, it's just a family VPN V4 and V6. On an industry standard CLI on the right, it looks a bit different, but the basic mechanism is right. This has to be activated on the lower link. On the service, you want to use EVPN. In this case, on Nokia, you just have to configure a VRF import and export policy and a route distinguisher. On Cisco or other vendors, this is similar. Route distinguisher is, I would say, used on every platform to mark the packets to which virtual networks they belong. Differences when operating this network. The route selection happens on more than one layer. Depending on what you want to achieve, you have to configure policies in your overlay network or in your underlay network. You depending on the vendor implementation, you have to query for a second address family when you're looking for routes. And the export policies are a bit different. Again, depending on your vendor, some integrated, some leave you the choice what to do. Filtering, you already think you have an export filter here to your upstream. You have it on your customer line, but again, you can do a bit of a mess of your whole network if you configure the filters in EVPN a bit wrong. Now for, let's say you're looking for a route because you want to troubleshoot your network. Second point, what has changed? You, in this case, I'm using virtual router 10. You're looking for a route to a known DNS server. You see that this route is known and the next hop has an IP address and it is tunneled and it's learned via BGP VPN. So this show is, for example, from a router in Mannheim and says that the route is known on the router 154 in Frankfurt. And this is comparable to a show IP route on a Cisco device. So now you want to see a bit more about the BGP information. On Cisco, you would do a show IP BGP. On Nokia, you do a show router 10 because you're on a virtual router 10 BGP routes, and it says no routes found. This is what I meant with you have to look at one more layer now, because in this specific implementation, routes learned via BGP are shown a bit different when you want to see them. You have to look in the underlay for the route if you want to see a BGP EVPN route. This is a bit weird, but you can get used to it. You just have to know that there is one more layer to query. Another thing which you can see here, I had configured always compare MAT on our BGP sessions, so on virtual router 10. But this does not mean that the MAT is also always compared first when running in, when doing BGP EVPN. You see that the upper route is marked as used, although it has a higher MAT because it has way less IGP cost. This can also be worked around with configuring always compare MAT on the lower layer. So on the EVPN session between the devices. So MAT comparison is done on the ingress in your normal BGP configuration, but it's also done on the BGP EVPN session. Export filtering, as I said, is also a bit different in this case, because export filtering also has a new statement from protocol BGP EVPN or BGP VPN. The nice thing with Nokia here is it does not depend on V6 and V4. We still have two prefixes we integrated, but this also could have done in one statement if we wanted to do it. In this case, if we only export routes from protocol BGP, we only export routes which the router also learns via BGP. The same as BGP VPN, it would also only include the far end routes learned via EVPN. Therefore, you always have to include both in this specific implementation. Other vendor might do it different, but I don't know if this is the only vendor or not. Just keep that in mind if you're doing some EVPN stuff in your network. Customer connectivity for us hasn't changed that much. On the access layer, customers still can get a patch, a DWDM connection or a VPLS connection, depending on where they are. On the routing part, they have the choice between a BGP full feed, a default route, or a static route. No big deal here. It mainly depends on I would say, their skills, what they want to have, and where they are located. Direct patch to our BGP router doesn't make any sense if it's not anywhere near our router. But within the data center for at least a 10 gig connection, just get a cross connect. The big picture of our network, how it's looking now, we've got Frankfurt, two routers on this AS running with upstreams to Deutsche Telekom, Telia level 3, and the usual peers you get in Frankfurt. We've got the two BGP routers running in the area here, Mannheim and Mutterstadt. We have BGP customer connections mainly in our area here, of course. We have a non-BGP customer aggregation for all the static stuff, which is located on separate boxes. And of course, we have customers which are single home to one AS or multi-home to two ASs of these. Current status, the network is fully in production. We have mostly removed the old hardware from production at the moment. As I said, we wanted to have the option to provide BGP as a service. We have already a couple of other BGP services running on this platform. One is for a NGN SIP interconnect to another provider to hand over voice traffic, which is in this case also handled by BGP. And we have other BGP sessions for connection to AWS or other cloud providers where there is no knowledge at the customer or just they wanted to offload it to us because we are a bit deeper into BGP than most of the enterprises are today. This all runs on the same systems without so much configuration, thanks to EVPN. And that's actually everything I have for you today. Questions now.
So thank you, Nico. I haven't really seen any particular questions around. Well, there is one from Kurt. What type of tools do you use to control the BGP policies in this network? Are you doing it manually or is there any automated fashion?
Currently, it's a mixture of Nokia's own network management platform to sync policies over the routers. But the normal filter lists are generated via BGP Q3. It has the option to put it out in Nokia CLI format, and therefore the easiest way is to do a BGP pipe SSH, or better compare with your old output of BGP Q3 and then put the diff into router. But it's mainly running on BGP Q3 at the moment for the filter list generation.
Okay. And then from that perspective, if you have a change, let's say from a customer wants to insert a couple of new prefixes into their VPN instance, is this triggered automatically? Do you use any kind of self-service portal? Do you use any APIs for that?
At the moment, it's not automatically. The plan is to generate the prefix automatically, but not to deploy it automatically. Just trigger an event and a notification to our team or our NOC that there is a new policy to be applied. But I definitely want to manually check it, because if something in the RIPE database or in the software goes wrong and it deploys an empty policy, that would be quite bad for the network. But this hasn't been automated yet due to other tasks and Corona coming up. But this is still on my list to do later on.
Do you also have some kind of plans for additional security mechanisms like yes. RPKI filtering?
Yes, this will definitely come, but again, not this year. But yes, we already implemented some knobs to not redo everything again when we want to do RPKI. We have max prefix set, we have the filter list at the moment. And we have some policies ready to roll out RPKI once the software is up in the data center and redundant. We don't want to solely rely on one server doing all the RPKI stuff, of course.
And then also on this side, you mentioned before that you also have some Juniper devices sitting next to the Nokias. Yes. Did you face any challenges in terms of interoperability between those various vendors, or was it with EVPN as it's supposed to be a smooth transition?
In this case, the Juniper device is running on a different AS, and it's just a normal BGP peer as anyone else would be. So there's no EVPN connection between the Nokia and the Juniper devices here. So also we didn't have any interop issues with the normal BGP.
Okay, then thanks a bunch, Nico. Really appreciate it. And therefore, we would close this talk. Thank you.